couldn't work it together where all four were together.
People love your podcast, man. I get a lot of retweets, whatever. Like they say that you had an amazing podcast. So and you can get
You guys play. Yeah, you guys play them every like third weekend here.
Oh, we do. Okay.
Yeah, so yeah, it's
great. Just played this weekend.
Yeah, a lot of people compare our Chip, your Chip character, to my B. I go, look, we're just we've hung out, we've known each other since 1990, and we just that's just the way we talk. Nobody took it from anybody.
No one took it. Florentine was Florentine long before Chip existed. I'll clear this up because Jim, like Chip, is like this, like what? It's not a takeoff on Jim at all. It's something I would do to annoy my girlfriend.
Yeah, and mine is just like, hey, really, you like
that?
Football?
Jim has been doing that before I knew.
That's a cross between like a retarded guy and Dice when Dice does the girl. Yeah. Voice. That's my. I like man caves.
What's that?
Yeah. Not, see, and that Chip
talking about a thumping.
Yeah. See, that's it's totally different.
It's the subtleties too. Chip, his upper lip covers his entire front row of teeth, whereas Florentine's guy, his front teeth are completely on display.
What's that? All right. Whatever. You sound
my man
stupid.
Cave.
Fucking idiot.
We got a sign on our man cave. What happens in the man cave stays in the man cave.
That's fucking hilarious. See, it's not. Neither is taking from either. But Jim
but
was
get
Jim.
Along.
Jim was Jim long before. So if anything, Chip came second. I still can't see an Applebee's without fuck. I literally me and Kenny this weekend because every fucking shit town I'm in has a bunch of them. Applebee's. But you see where my teeth are?
Yeah.
Applebee's.
It's a neighborhood bar and grill.
Yeah, it's fun for everyone.
Yeah, it's
Applebee's.
You feel like you're in the neighborhood.
Yeah, you guys want to go to Applebee's? That's all me and Kenny will say in the car.
I don't feel like I'm in your neighborhood. What is the slogan?
I don't know.
Eating good in the neighborhood.
Eating good in the neighborhood.
Applebee's.
No, I'm not. I'd rather eat one of fucking Jim Norton's fucking prostitute logs that land on his chest.
You and Jim Norton both. All right, we'll be back. Henry Bushkin, I guess, is checking in early. And I'm gonna take a leak, and I have to do a quick break. And I'm going to read this well.
The Opie and Anthony Show.
Our guest has, our first guest has arrived.
Yeah.
And now you bring him in. Hendry. Let me move this. Hello, sir. We're on the air. Oh, yeah, keep your phone. Now, that was a professional. Henry was trying to hand his phone to Travis.
Travis is like, no, keep it.
Don't trust him. He'll go throw it.
How are you guys?
Good.
Nice to be here.
Which, incidentally, handing your phone over, very brave. You must have nothing to hide, because I would never just hand my phone to somebody.
Nothing.
Are you password protected?
Password protected.
Oh, okay.
Totally protected. Condoms, everything.
Are you use condoms? That's another thing I don't happen to agree with. I think they're overrated. Well, welcome to the show. You smell
Thanks.
Good.
Thank you.
You wear
Thank
good
you.
Cologne. I guess we're here to talk about your book. And I
hope so.
Yeah.
I hope so.
No, it's condoms. Yeah, it's smelling good.
Yeah, imagine if I only asked about your cologne and your password. I just tried to get your password out of you. I finished your book last night. It was excellent.
Thank you.
And I guess to start, you know, you were Carson's lawyer from what years?
1970 through 1988.
What type of lawyer-client confidence do you have where you're able to write a book? What is the law on that? Like, don't you have to sign, like, non-disclosures or?
Well, the law is that the attorney-client privilege ceases with death. So it ceases with death. It's as simple as that.
Oh, okay. How do you think he would feel about this book? Would he feel betrayed?
I think he would feel delighted that people are talking about him again. I think that's the real thing here, that this is a renaissance, hopefully, for Johnny. He deserves it. He's looked at by, I think, every comedian today as the gold standard. And I think if this book helps in part serve that renaissance, I think it's a good thing.
You pointed out, too, that you met him under very odd circumstances through a friend who you were going to help with. What exactly was it you were brought on to help him with?
I was brought on to help him look into an apartment that he thought his wife had. That was simply my job, to go there, to be the lawyer in case something happened, nothing more.
You mean, now this is Joanne Carson, who he lived with and was married to, had an apartment set up somewhere else?
That's correct.
And that was a big story in the Post. They've actually been talking about your book a lot, where she was allegedly fucking Frank Gifford.
Right.
And that was what was at least alleged.
Well, again, that chapter, that was just a fact. It wasn't the point of the chapter at all. It had to do with how I met Johnny. And the scene at the bar at the end of that chapter was the big reveal in that chapter, giving me a whole lowdown on his personality, his psyche, his sense of tragedy, because it was at that moment that it was a tragic moment.
Well, can you walk us through that a little bit? Just because it was very interesting to me that your second day of knowing this guy or whatever, you're walking to a secret apartment that his wife has that he thinks she is sharing with someone else. And he was the host of the Tonight Show, and he brought you into this very private moment relatively quickly.
No question. It was shocking to me, and I think it was shocking to everybody who knew me that Johnny Carson actually hired me to do something.
What did you see when you got into that apartment that she was allegedly having with Frank Gifford?
Well, you say allegedly, I was there.
Oh, okay. So I don't know what the right... Okay, that she had with Gifford. Cool.
I'm not subscribing anything to you, but I was there. Again, the apartment and the incident in the apartment, taking some evidence, taking photos and leaving, was simply, one of those moments that 30 years later, you could have fun with it. 30 years ago is tragic, or 40, whatever, however long it was. So tragedy, a lot of years, you get some comedy. So I intended it to be lighthearted in that sense, because it was 43 years ago. I mean, who cares? This is 43 years ago. So all the hubbubaloo in the papers is shocking to me. I'm fascinated by it because, again, the point of this chapter was not Joanne Carson and an illicit apartment. It just happened to be the basis how I met the guy.
It is interesting, though, because of the fact that we saw Carson. He was one of my idols growing up. We see him one way. He's Johnny of the Tonight Show. You got so close, then I don't know if it's harder for you to realize how little of him most of us know. But you talk about him carrying a pistol and breaking down and crying there, realizing his wife is probably having an affair. Like that's a big thing for people to read about a guy like Johnny Carson.
Well, I listened to your question. Probably having an affair is probably an understatement.
So you think she was fucking his brains out?
Why? Because there was clothes in the closet and pictures of him on the wall?
Things like that.
Yeah.
Things like that. Photographs.
Clues.
Taking evidence. We did our job. Let's put it that way. We did our job. I had a job to do. I did it. I never thought about it again until I wrote the book, to tell you the truth. It was not something that I ever spoke about because it was one of those moments that you just don't want to tell people about. And so, again, 43 years after the event, I think you could have some fun with it. Sorry that Joanne Carson isn't, but what could I say?
Well, yeah, Joanne's denying it, and then Frank Gifford says, I can't remember if that happened or not.
Well, you choose.
Right. Yeah. And then Joanne said that Johnny would have never had a gun. He wasn't into guns at all.
Johnny would from the day I met him, he carried a gun, and I knew him for 18 years. So what more could I say about that?
Yeah.
You know for a fact he had it, and I believe that he had it. And there's a reason for him to have it.
Well, again, I was there, and you know, I'm not alleging something. I'm telling you what the facts were.
Right, it was your experience.
He did carry a gun. He was the subject of such intense scrutiny by everybody when they saw him. And there was one incident that I wrote about where he was subject to an extortion attempt. And he wouldn't let the cops make the drop. He insisted on doing it. And if you don't think he had his .38 on the seat of that car, you got to be kidding.
Right.
With the cops, with the FBI, with every agency you could think of looking on, this is who he was. He had brass balls when it came to that.
And you told a story, too, which was great, about that night in the bar, which was after this happens. And you're sitting there, and he's just kind of spilling his guts to you. And what do you think it was about you that got a guy who was so private among so many people to just look at you and go, this is the guy I'm going to start telling all this stuff to?
I don't know that he saw anything in me, but I could tell you that at that point in his life, he had very few people, if anybody, that he could turn to and rely on. His life was a mess in 1970. There's no question about it. His marriage was bad. He was drinking. He had problems with his manager. He had problems with the show. He had a number of different things going on and nobody to turn to. And so I was the guy who just happened to be there. Maybe you call it just very, very lucky. Right circumstances, right timing, and I was there.
Did he ever miss a show from drinking too much, from partying? Because it seemed like he had a major alcohol problem.
Again, I met him in 1970, and the drinking was mostly in the late 60s with Ed McMahon when they were running around in New York. When he moved to California in 1972, most of that had subsided pretty well. And he got married, and that sort of calmed him down for quite some time.
So it wasn't like he was loaded all the time?
No, not at all. And I didn't mean to suggest that. Right. Some reports have said that, and it's just not true. He drank. A lot of people drink. A lot of people get loaded on occasion.
Right, and most of the crazy stories come out when people are loaded. So
you
that's
bet.
What, yeah.
You bet. And that's what you hear about today. But don't forget, back then, no phones, no cell phones, no cameras, no paparazzi hanging around when we were inside a place. So we were very comfortable, and you could drink. And he did. I mean, it's as simple as that. Lots of people did.
Do you remember the? I watched the Dorothy Stratton interview with that old play. Do you know who she was?
No.
Oh, okay. So you won't remember. I was going to ask you a question about it, but it doesn't matter. She was a Playboy model who was murdered by her husband not long after Carson.
Johnny had nothing to do with it, nor did I.
Yeah. And it wasn't because of the interview. She didn't say anything that got her shot. Do you remember? Now, the Joan Rivers thing, of course you remember, but that's for some reason, people took a very harsh view of Johnny Carson from that. Like, oh, he's this cold-hearted son of a bitch, and how could he not wish her well? And, you know, what do you think people got wrong about that?
Well, as you describe it, everything. He never received a call from her or her husband, nor did I, telling Johnny or me that she was going to do this. His point of view after the fact was, if she had come to me, if she'd asked me, I would have wished her well. I would have said good luck. And the fact that she was going in competition against him didn't bother him, because his point of view was Joan Rivers was sensational, but no more than 1 week at a time. You put her on 2 weeks at a time, it's too much. You put her on 3 weeks at a time, too much. And he was right. And I could assure you that if she did that and the show failed, he would have welcomed her back.
Yeah, wouldn't he interview people that had gone up against him, like, who was it, Cabot, or a few other guys who flopped, and he'd have them on the show?
Look, he was as smart as anybody. Radio's a business, television's a business. His line was, if a gorilla could do his job, they'd replace him with a gorilla, because he'd be cheaper.
Right.
And it's true. So Joan Rivers was a terrific guest host, maybe the best. And she screwed him by not letting him know. And there's stories out there that her husband supposedly called me, which didn't happen. And frankly, I attribute the whole mess to her husband, because he was a secretive guy, and he was a difficult guy. And I think that's the cause of the problem. He told her, he called me, he never did. She was satisfied. She did what she did. And then Johnny got supremely aggravated and never spoke to her again. It's as simple as that.
Because she told a story, too, where she, that's kind of, that makes sense, that the husband probably told her that just because he knew it was a career move for her and that she'd never be able to take over for Carson. Did she try to call him? Like did Johnny, he didn't call her or send her anything when Edgar committed suicide? And didn't she call when Rick had died and he just wouldn't respond to it?
Well, when Rick died, I was no longer representing him, so I can't tell you what happened when Rick died. After the incident with Joan taking her show, as far as I knew, as long as I was there, he never spoke to her, and he never would. Now, maybe if he were alive today, he might have a change of heart, but not then. He wasn't that type of guy. Once you were out of his life, that was it.
He severed relationships fairly quickly. And completely.
I'm not sure that they were fairly quickly, but when he did, it was over. He didn't have any remorse. He just didn't. And that wasn't in his psyche.
The documentary on him was great recently. I think there's like a really renewed interest in Carson for some reason.
I hope that was the beginning of sort of a renaissance. This book was written long before that PBS special was put on. Indeed, the producer tried to get me on a number of different times. All of which I refused, simply because I didn't want to talk about him. I really didn't. And this book came out really almost as a result of that show, because I felt all the warts were sort of exposed in that show. And this book of mine put some meat on the bones of what people were talking about.
Right.
So I don't have any regrets about this. And after that PBS special, Johnny would have been, I think, delighted today that people are talking about him. I think that's basically the bottom line.
Did he enjoy fame? Like, did he like being famous?
Well, when he did The Tonight Show in those days, when he walked out on stage, everybody in the audience stood up and applauded. Now, you know, that's a hard act to follow. When you go home, everybody has stood up and the wife meets you with some plumbing problems. It's hard to adjust to that.
Yeah.
And so the fame that he had was such that it was very difficult for him to sort of be a normal person immediately. Leave the show and all of a sudden become a normal person. Wasn't that easy.
What would you guys do on the road? Because I didn't ever realize that Carson did gigs. Like, I never realized that he went out and did road gigs up until 1980, and you said he played Vegas and he played clubs. And what was that like, being on the road, his kind of routine for a gig?
Well, Vegas was basically, he would finish The Tonight Show on a Friday night. The two of us would drive to Burbank Airport, where his plane would pick us up, take us to Las Vegas in about 40 minutes. And by the time the opening act, Phyllis McGuire, was done, he was well into his act. He was comfortable, did two shows, Friday and Saturday. And in those days, he was making $250,000 a weekend for two shows.
And what year was that he was making $125,000 a show?
This was 1980.
Wow. Okay.
So 1980, he's making that amount of money. And, you know, by today's standards, almost, it doesn't seem like a lot, you know, because you could have an Eagles concert.
Yeah.
They could gross $2 million a night, you know, so $250. But then it was more than Sinatra was making. Okay.
It was
more than Sinatra was making, because with Johnny there was no expenses. You know, I mean, Johnny was in one. They had the house orchestra with his band leader and an opening act which consisted of Phyllis McGuire, and it was a simple show. It was cheap, you know, very cheap, and it was always packed. So in those days, I would say he was probably the highest paid performer in Las Vegas as well. And he was doing roughly 10 weekends a year. So multiply that. It's $2.5 million for 20 days. Not bad.
Was he doing monologue jokes, like an hour of just jokes, or was it a variety show?
No. He was in one. He was purely in one, in front of the curtain for 90 minutes. So he was maybe the best stand-up in one you've ever seen. And hopefully one day we'll be able to recreate that in another form. But he was brilliant.
Was he a stand-up before? Because, like, everybody knows Leno, Letterman, they were pure stand-ups. Carson, I always just thought of as a TV host, but had he done stand-up before?
No. You got to understand, guys, he started in television in 1949, okay? There was no stand-up in 1949. There was radio, and then there was television, you know, and there was, like, small clubs that you could play, but he was basically doing magician type of work before that, right? So he was doing radio, then he did television. So he didn't do any stand-up. His act came about as a result of doing The Tonight Show. The other guys had an act before they did The Tonight Show. His act after
that. After that kind of came from doing it.
Yeah. But I have to tell you, anybody who's seen him, okay, you could ask Wayne Newton, who is a brilliant, you know, Las Vegas performer. Ask Wayne Newton, who didn't particularly like Johnny, how good he was as a performer. He was brilliant.
Yeah, did he really threaten to kick Carson's ass?
Oh, yeah, I think he did. I wasn't at the studio at the time, but I've spoken to Wayne about it.
And what did he say?
And, well, it all stemmed from Johnny making Wayne Newton gay jokes. And after a while...
Was he doing, I didn't know it was the gay jokes.
Yeah, it was Wayne Newton gay jokes.
On The Tonight Show or in his live act?
On The Tonight Show. No, this was wow. On The Tonight Show. So Wayne is a big guy, part Indian, rough guy, lives in Las Vegas, is a horseman, and a nice guy. I can't. These two were vying for the Aladdin Hotel at one point, and we dropped out for various reasons. The FBI suggested we drop out. We did drop out. Wayne Newton got the hotel, the Aladdin Hotel. It was in bankruptcy. And Johnny got pissed that he was getting all the publicity that he beat out Carson. When he didn't beat out Carson, we dropped out. But the press said he beat out Carson. So Carson got pissed, and hence Wayne Newton gay jokes.
And so Wayne went to NBC?
Well, from what you heard? Again, I wasn't there, so this is what Wayne tells me. I believe it happened after I left, by the way. So I believe it happened, but I can't really validate.
But he must have been like, what the fuck's Wayne Newton doing here? Like, you know.
I think so.
And what was the another thing that got a lot of press that you wrote about was there was a genuine mob hit on Carson put out in way back in the early 70s or late 60s?
Right here in New York, Johnny and Ed out drinking one night at Chili's and try to pick up two girls at the bar. They happened to be the wife of and the sister of one of the members of the, let's say, a notorious gang family here in New York, unbeknownst to Johnny. Well, the windup was, after Jilly got him out of there, he was told that the husband was out to get him, that he was going to kill him because of what Johnny had done. Now, basically, Johnny hit out, I can't say hit out. He just didn't leave the house. He just didn't leave UN Plaza. And Dave Tebbett, who was an NBC executive, called up, after hearing all this, called up his buddy at William Morris, who dealt with what we call bent noses, guys who he had a relationship with some people in that family. And because it was the Italian-American, it was Columbus Day. It was actually Columbus Day today,
right,
that they were having an Italian-American parade, and nobody would cover it. No network would cover it, simply because it was basically the mafia saying we're good guys, you know, so they organized the parade. So they would, NBC was told, you cover the parade. If you cover the parade, we'll let Carson off the hook. So if you go back, you'll find NBC was the only network that carried that parade, and Carson then went back to work.
They threw him down a flight of stairs, too, when they found
out? Well, that was before the threat.
Before the threat, like that night when they found out he was hitting on the girls.
Well, some other guys did that, okay, who happened to be around, okay? Then the husband came. Johnny, by that time, had left.
Johnny, did he not do the Tonight Show for the next few nights?
Three nights
he missed a show because of this.
Yeah. Wow. So he took it very seriously.
I would have, too.
Yeah. Now, did the guy want to kill him just because he hit on his wife, or was he rude about it? Because if he didn't know she was married, I mean...
Well, I don't think he knew very much. I think he was pretty loaded, and I don't know what went on, obviously, but it was serious enough that it was taken seriously by the husband, who was out to get Johnny for a couple of days.
And I love hearing stories about his mother, because you wouldn't think that Carson would be intimidated or alpha, whatever, by anybody, but his mother really was a rough one.
She was what I would describe as Midwestern Gothic. Very cold, very sort of aloof.
You knew her?
Very well. And always polite, and always considerate, and actually quite charming. But, you know, that doesn't mean that was the relationship she had with her son or other children, for that matter. And he never could get any love from her, any warmth from her. Indeed, the PBS special that we spoke about talked about her being in the green room and saying to her son, John, you weren't very funny tonight. I mean, come on. And he sent his parents on a 47-day trip around the world and gave them a gold American Express card before they left and said to his father, Dad, anything you want, wherever you stop, put it on the card. It's on me. So in 47 days, they never bothered to call him to say, we're having a great time. We're doing this. We're doing that. 47 days, doesn't hear from them. And when they finally get home and he finally calls them, she tells him, John, we're so happy to be home. Not a word about we had a great time. Anything normal that you would expect.
A postcard, anything. a hello?
Nothing. So that's prototypical of his mother, and that's, I think, a good reveal on why he was who he was. It was very difficult for him to express any sort of emotion because of her.
But his dad seemed like, you know, he couldn't have been too terrific either, because he also could have picked up a phone.
The dad was completely under the thumb of the mom. I mean, she ruled the roost. The dad didn't do anything without checking with his wife. It was one of the, I mean, you guys all know circumstances like that. That happened to be the Carson family. The father would say virtually nothing, and a very elegant guy, shocking crop of white hair, good-looking guy, but the mom, she ruled the roost.
And there's obviously, Carson was, you forget how handsome he was. Like, he was a good-looking dude. Like, you look back at the old footage of him. So there's obviously a lot of women around.
Well, in those days, there were a lot of women around every star in those days. Carson was no different. I mean, you know, I mean, the book is certainly about Johnny. But do you think he was any different than Sinatra? I don't think so. Or Bob Hope? No. Or Jack Benny? Or any of the greats of that period, or even before him? They were all alike. They all drank. They all caroused. I mean, there are exceptions, of course. But he was no different.
And you obviously got a little bit of the benefit of that, I would hope. Being the friend, you know, you're there all the time. There's got to be always at least one friend with a girl.
Occasionally, that was true.
Yeah. There were. And there were probably hot chicks, too. There probably wasn't any fat ones hanging out.
No fat ones.
Nice.
No fat ones. I remember a line that Johnny had one night. We were sitting at the bar, and I thought it was like either the best line I ever heard or the cruelest. This woman came in, obviously with her daughter, and it was obviously the daughter, you know, that had the looks that we were interested in, but the mom came along, so Johnny looked at the mom. And these two were just thrilled to be sitting, you know, at the same table as Johnny Carson. He looked at the mother and he said, "I'm so sorry you lost your last fight." And I said, "Did he say that to her? Did he say, 'I'm so sorry you lost your last fight'?" And they sort of laughed, and then it took you like 5 minutes to realize what he actually said, but it was so
that she
cutting.
Was ugly.
It was so cutting. She never got it. You know? She never got it. And I'm saying, wow, what a line to use on somebody.
That's the best line. Right? Not cruel.
Did he wind up banging the daughter?
I'm not sure.
Oh. So how did your relationship with him end?
Well, it ended, I'd say, quickly and sort of very much in line with how relationships with him ended. It was like a 3-minute conversation. We shook hands. This was at his Malibu residence, and I left. That was the end of the sort of the official lawyer relationship. The relationship went on another 6 or 7 months, you know, on a variety of different things, including some matters that were sort of very touchy that I was handling,
right,
that he didn't want me turning over to the other lawyer, but it really involved his son in Florida, so there was another lawyer involved. So I kept in touch for about another 8 months, and that was it.
Did you ever feel in the relationship that it was going to end badly? Because it happened with a lot of other his past relationships, like, man, if I screw up one time, I'm going to be out just like everybody else, including like Joan Rivers and other people in his life.
At many times, I'm certain I felt that way, but practically, you know, we were partners in many respects, so it just couldn't end that way like it did with Joan Rivers. There were much more, it's like a marriage that you had to sort of unravel in certain respects. But yeah, it's very quick, and it's pretty much final. He, as I said earlier, he doesn't go back and rethink these things. It's over.
I kind of admire that, even though maybe he's made some shitty decisions. I wish I had that ability. I just keep people hanging on, and I still talk to exes. I wish I could just
It's a coldness. You know, you got to understand it. If you're not sort of brutally cold in that sense, it's hard to imagine, you know, breaking a relationship with a wife and never speaking to her again. I mean, just never. And that was the interesting thing about Joanne Carson, because he never spoke to her again, at least in the 18 years that I represented him. And she talks in interviews as if she spoke to him every day. So it's that's also kind of interesting to me.
I thought it was what a dumb thing he did that you tried to advise him against when he was marrying Joanna. You had a prenup, and he just decided not to have a prenup. Like, for what?
A gallantry. I think he felt, don't forget, this was 1972, and prenups are not like they are today in California. They're almost like required. It's almost like even if you have nothing, you almost get a prenup when you get married. So then it was very much sort of avant-garde almost. And he felt, I think, that it was not a great way to start the marriage. So you got to commend him for that. I mean, it may have been silly, but you really have to commend sort of the gallantry of that.
How'd that work out financially in the end?
Well, let's put it this way. He died worth almost $500 million. So what difference does it make?
Well, you know, she got a lot
of... It cost him about $35 million. But, you know, in the end of the day, when you think about it, it's almost like, so what?
You know, even if you're worth half a billion, there's no way anyone can be happy with $35 million.
Especially when he finds out that she's having an affair.
No, different woman. Different woman.
Oh, this is Joanna.
This is Joanna.
All right,
right.
That's right. This is wife number three.
Wife number three.
Yeah, this is Joanna.
There was four wives, right? Then he remarried again later in his life.
Yes.
And yeah, he said that little gesture cost him $35 million, which is just
as he would say to me, listen, the next time I want to get married, find me some woman I don't like, and I'll give her a house, and I'll be done with it. Good line, right?
Yeah.
And you didn't seem to care for his last wife. I just got that vibe reading what you wrote.
You know, I really didn't know her very well. I certainly wouldn't say I didn't like her at all. I mean, she was very nice.
Okay.
She was a wife that I describe as she could have been a legal secretary, she could have been a great real estate agent, she could have been an administrative assistant, very attractive. And in Los Angeles, there are lots of very attractive women like that. And so what I said is she could have been anybody. Okay, she just happened to be like me at the right place at the right time to see him when he was completely single, if you will. And that was his fourth wife. And again, my relationship with him ended, okay, very soon after that marriage began. Now, if you said, well, was she a contributing factor? I couldn't answer that, you know, but perhaps. I just don't know.
Well, he accused you. I know you guys had Carson Productions. And we're trying to, he wanted to unload it. And I guess they wanted $100 million for it. And you didn't think it would get $100 million. So you had spoken to somebody about possibly getting $60 million, and you wanted more, but they offered $60 million, and you had a deal with it. And he thought you were trying, you and Ed Weinberger were trying to take the company out from under him.
That's my understanding. I didn't speak to him directly about it, but actually he did. In our three-minute meeting, he did tell me that I was trying to steal the company from him, now that you mention it. And what happened, it was an offer that I brought to his investment bankers. They were representing his company. And that was the reason that we broke up our relationship. I wanted to build the company. He wanted to end the company. And so the company that we had created, the investment bankers were asking $100 million. The offer that I received was $60 million because they wanted Ed Weinberger and myself to come along with the company.
Would you have left Carson to do that?
Or? I was already gone.
Okay.
So certainly I would have left because I had left.
Why did he want to sell the company?
He didn't want it anymore. He wanted to just do the Tonight Show. That was the reason that we broke up, in effect. As a business guy, I'm trying to build something, and the more success we had, the less he liked it. The more time I spent on the business and not on him, the less he liked it. So we were going at that point in opposite directions. Our goals had diverged at some point.
Why did he not want that business?
Simply because the only thing he wanted in life was to do the Tonight Show. He had no as it turns out, he had no ambitions beyond the Tonight Show. That was sad as far as I was concerned, because the intuitive thing that, that we as business guys do. You try to build something. You don't try to not build it. You try to build it. You don't try to destroy it. So what we had built up, he said to me one day, sell it. And I said, we've got 100 people working for us. I mean, you just don't stop and sell it. He said, no, I want to sell it. And so with him, when he said I wanted to sell it, that was it. There was no turning around. So I refused actually to be a part of that, and that's what ended our relationship.
Were you? No, I know you weren't stealing from him, or I don't think you were, but were you, was there anything that was a little questionable with you because you wanted to stay, keep the company, and you wanted, Ed Weinberg wanted to kind of stay with it? Was there anything that you weren't telling him or kind of doing like, fuck him, he doesn't need to know that?
No. It was his company. I didn't, you know, I owned a small part of it, but it was his company, and he could do with it what he wished. This was just, in effect, what you'd call a backup offer. You guys go sell it for whatever you want, and if you can't for some reason and you're interested in this, here it is. So that was presented to him as if I was trying to buy it for that amount. It wasn't my money. I think it was the Tribune Company was trying to buy it or wanted to buy it. And it got turned around, as things often do in Hollywood, showbiz, you know. And that's what happened.
Have you spoken to Joan Rivers in all these years?
I haven't spoken to her at all.
If you saw her, would you two speak?
I certainly would. I don't even know if she would remember me, to tell you the truth. This, again, the last time, and we were friends. I mean, it's not like, but I haven't seen her, I think, since 1985.
Oh, okay. I'm wondering if she blamed you at all.
Perhaps.
Well, the book is called Johnny Carson. It's on sale. When does it come out? Tomorrow?
I believe it comes out tomorrow, yes.
Well, it was absolutely great, and I actually made myself stop reading it so I could finish it closer to the interview, because I was ripping through it, so I saved myself about 40 pages to finish yesterday, and I did. And I thank you for coming in. The book was tremendous.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate the compliments, and I enjoyed being here.
Who would, if Johnny was alive today, who would he like best in late night, you think? Would he be a Letterman fan? I know he wanted Letterman to get the gig and all of that.
Well, we didn't get into that, but here today. But I was asked that question before, and I don't think he'd be watching any late night comedy show. I think he'd be watching sports. I think he'd be watching Fox, CNN. That's what he did. He never watched his own show, so I doubt that he'd be watching someone else's show. I just don't think that would be the case, even if they were, you know, top of the heap by far. You know, I think all these guys are terrific, but I don't think he'd be watching any one of them.
Was he as good a tennis player as he thought he was?
No.
Thank you very much. Thanks for coming in. We'll be back
in
a few minutes.
Good meeting you.